Have you ever wondered what the world would be without sampling? That means no soul samples, no lo-fi, no Kanye West College Dropout album, no Q-Beats loops, no nothing. I think we can agree that that shit sounds awful. Well, that's what I thought when I saw Keishonada say, "We can't let this sampling shit die." This left me thinking about all the contributions from all the different regions of America and how they changed sampling in their own special way. Memphis with their dark sound, Texas with their chopped and screwed soul samples, the West Coast with G-Funk, New York with their street gritty anthems, Chicago with their sped up soul samples. But there's one person in particular that sticks out and gives inspiration to new generations even after his death. And his name is J Dilla. The man, the machine, the soul. This is how J Dilla changed sampling forever. If you're a sample lover, it's next to impossible for you to not come across his work. I'm pretty sure you've heard this song. J Dilla's music made such an impact that it became timeless. It touched and inspired so many different generations that even a 7-year-old kid remade that song. Even if this is your first time hearing about Dilla, you'd be amazed at how many of your favorites admired him and considered him a legend.
J Dilla, one of my favorite producers of all time. He just had a crazy sound.
As soon as Dilla walked in, Rael got down on his knees and started like bowing to him.
It's like he was making Quincy Jones production sessions just inside of his MPC.
When you hear Dilla beat, it's hard not to bop to it. From his unique drums to his unique sample. What is the driving force that makes someone like him take this?
I wanna love you, yeah, yeah, over and over again,
and turn it into this? How did this Detroit producer make his sound so infectious? Well, in order to find that out, you have to look beyond the technique and look at the one thing all his tracks have. Chapter 1, The Soul. What is soul? It's the true expression of oneself. Dilla is from Detroit, and Detroit has one of the most iconic labels ever, Motown. Motown housed some of the greatest artists in the world. Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Diana Ross, the Jackson 5, and the main contributor to the Motown sound, Smokey Robinson. It's no wonder why his music sounded like that. It's all he knew. Those greats were his reference points. Much like the records he was sampling, soul had to be the main driver over technicality. Although he didn't know music theory, and he wasn't an amazing bass player or a genius on the keys, he was a guy that followed his curiosity, and that curiosity happened to be fueled by passion and intuition. It was in sampling those records that he realized sampling was his instrument. Chapter 2, The Voice. Dilla discovered sampling was his voice, and with the use of the classic Akai MPC 3000 as his main instrument, he became obsessed with sampling. In the day and age of the internet, it's hard to find songs that someone hasn't already sampled. And at one point in every producer's journey, they found themselves saying, "He already flipped that sample, I can't use that." But as time progresses, they realize it's not about who samples it, but it's about how you flip it.
And I also knew that Ludacris used this for Splash Waterfalls, the same sample. So now I'm thinking, okay, I have to flip it another way, so I'm fighting against 3 or 4 different thought processes.
To Dilla, it didn't matter what anybody else did. He made it work for him. So how was his chopping style different than others? In my view, he was a puzzle artist. He would take small pieces, and sometimes pieces from other puzzles, then rearrange them into a completely new abstract idea. In music theory, this would be considered wrong. But no matter the technicality, it felt right. Taking pieces and rearranging them was something that he was gifted at. To him, just because it was played one way didn't mean he couldn't take the notes and rearrange them to create something special. Dilla wasn't trying to do music the right way. He wasn't trying to do it anybody else's way. He was just doing it his way, the way that felt good to him. Regardless of time signature, he made it sound crazy. Dilla would also leave messages to his family, friends, and fans through his unique sampling. A great example of this is one of his last songs, Don't Cry, off of his 2006 album, Donuts.
I can't stand to see you cry.
Dilla would also add multiple tracks to one beat. You probably heard this sound. This alarm was like his tag before tags. In hip hop, you can't have a hard beat without slapping drums and bass. Chapter 3, The Groove. There are many quotes from various artists in the past that have worked with him saying that he made drums sound broken. Many even stated that they were in disbelief the first time they heard his drums because it sounded nothing like what he was using. He made drums sound like they didn't come off that MPC machine. He would take stale drums like this, then give them a more human feel by not hitting the quantize button like this. Quantize is when you take something that is off the grid and snap it back into place. This gives music a more robotic and unnatural feel. Even his bass lines from the mini-moog Voyager have a natural groove and feel. Chapter 4, The Legacy. Even though Dilla passed away, his legacy still lives on. Because of his influence, he continues to inspire music creators today. Artists and producers cite J Dilla as a major inspiration for their unique sound. If you learn anything from Dilla, you learn that rules don't matter when creating records. What matters is the feeling and the soul put into those records. That's the magic. In order to stand out, you must express yourself. I think the best thing we can do to honor Dilla in the highest form is to be true to ourselves and express what's inside of us, because the world needs it. That's what Dilla would do. So, moral of the story? We can't let the sampling shit die. So, that's the end of the video. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope the message of the video resonates with you, and it really puts you onto something. And if you didn't know who J Dilla was, well, now you have a perfect introduction. So subscribe, let me know what else in the comments you want to see, and I'll do my best to make it happen with Splice. If you are a longtime Dilla fan, man, let me know in the comments down below what's your favorite Dilla song. I love Turn Me Up Some, the song he did with Busta Rhymes. It just sounds so like, just, it's something about that beat. This is part of a series that I do called The Framework. Got a ton of episodes on TikTok and even on my YouTube channel. So let me know down below in the comments what else you guys want to see, and I'll do my best to make it happen. Splice will do their best to make it happen. And yeah, so with that being said, I'll catch you guys next time.